In this video, I'm going to explain what the empirical formula is, and I'm going to explain how to find it from the molecular formula. So let's start off with the definitions of both molecular and empirical formulas. So molecular formula is basically what you're used to in class. It's the thing that you're going to see the most when you see these elements written like this with their atomic symbols and a little subscript. And the definition is that it's telling you exactly how many of each element you have in your molecule. So when we look at this first example, we look at C2H4O2. We know that that molecule 100% has two carbons, it has four hydrogens, and it has two oxygens. That's what the molecular formula is trying to tell us. And so now, let's go over to the empirical formula. So the empirical formula tells you the ratio of the elements in your molecule, but not exactly how many you have. So whenever you're looking at an empirical formula, you don't know exactly how many carbons, hydrogens, oxygens, or whatever else is in your molecule you have. All you know is the ratio to each other. So a common type of problem that you guys are going to be expected to do is to go from molecular formula to empirical formula. So let's just do these six practice problems. So first we have C2H4O2. And so the way we get to the empirical formula is we just look at all of our subscripts. So in this case, we have 2, 4, and 2. And you just think to yourself, can these three numbers be divided by anything? And you don't get a decimal or a fraction. You get another integer, another whole number. And so in this case, all three of these numbers can be divided by 2. So that's what we're going to have to do. So now I'm going to rewrite all of our elements. It's still going to be carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen in our final answer. But now all of my subscripts are going to be what they were in the molecular formula, but divided by 2. So for carbon, we have 2 divided by 2, that's 1. Hydrogen, we have 4 divided by 2, that's just 2. And then for oxygen, we have 2 again divided by 2, that's 1. And we know that when we have a subscript of 1, it's not necessary that we show it, so our final answer could look like this. All right, so that's all we have to do to go from molecular to empirical. So now let's do our second example, H2O. So again, we look at our subscripts and we ask ourselves, can all of the subscripts be divided by something that gets us a lower whole number for everything, no fractions, no decimals? So here I have the subscript 2 for H, and since there's no subscript written for oxygen, it means it's secretly 1. So my numbers I have to deal with are 2 and 1. And so now there's nothing I can divide both of these numbers by to get anything lower that's still a whole number. Since 1 can't get any smaller without it becoming a fraction, we're not going to get to 0, we're not going into negative numbers here. 1 is the smallest integer that you can have in an element with it still being there. There's nothing we can divide by. I mean, we could divide by 1, but that just gives us the same answer. So there's really nothing we can do. So for anything that has any element that just has 1 in it, the answer is just going to be the same. So we just have H2O, O is 1. Of course, we don't have to write that in our final answer. We can just write H2O. And so that's another thing. The molecular formula will often be the exact same as the empirical formula. There's going to be lots of examples you do where there is no difference, where it happens that exactly how many you have in your molecule is the lowest whole number ratio. There is no lower you can go. So never be scared that it's like, uh-oh, I couldn't find anything. That's completely fine. Any test you get, you're going to have some problems where the molecular formula is the same as the empirical formula. All right, so now let's go to our next example. We have CH2O. Just a reminder, if there's no subscripts written, it means our carbon and our oxygen's actually 1. So here we have another example where we have a bunch of 1s in here, and we can't really make 1 any lower and still have it be accurate for any molecular formula. That just wouldn't make sense to have half an oxygen or a negative oxygen. 1 is the lowest we can go. So this again is going to be the same. There's no division to do here. So my answer is just CH2O. Just skipping the step where I show the 1. All right, so now we have Al3F9. So looking at this, we can see that our subscripts are 3 and 9, and both of these are divisible by 3. So when we do that, we're going to still have our same elements, Al and F, But aluminum becomes 1, and 9 gets divided by 3 to become 3. So our final answer just looks like this. All right, so now C4H6. So we have 4 and 6, and so both of those can be divided by 2. And so really, in all these problems, the numbers are going to be pretty low. You're probably not going to have some molecule where it's C500,013 or something. So all you have to do is just kind of look and eyeball it and say, okay, I'm just kind of checking my brain. Is there anything I can divide it by? So it's very rare that in doing these problems, you would have to divide by any really large number. It's pretty much going to be 2, 3, maybe 4 or 5. It's not going to go that high. So the math isn't going to be super challenging on these problems. It's just about looking for connections within your subscripts and kind of seeing, is there anything immediately where I'm like, I know that's divisible by something. So with this, we're going to get C, 4 divided by 2 is 2. And 6 divided by 2 is 3. So this is our final answer for this. And then last but not least, we have C4H7. And so just kind of checking in with you guys, making sure that even when you have a molecule where you don't have 1, there are still some instances where you won't be able to divide by anything. So 4 and 7, there is no number that we can divide both of those by and get lower, just whole numbers. Anything we do is going to give us a fraction. So we are just going to have this be the same. And our answer is just going to be C4H7. So in conclusion, here are all of our final answers. So just a couple of more facts about empirical formula. So as you can see, we were able to go pretty easily from molecular formula to empirical formula. So a lot of students ask, okay, how do I go to empirical formula to molecular formula? And the answer is that you can't unless you're given the molar mass, and that's its own type of problem that we're not going to do in this video. So unless your teacher has given you problems where you have the molar mass and the empirical formula and you have to break everything down to get to molecular, there's no way to just look at empirical and know what the molecular formula is. So don't expect to do that without doing a bunch of work. And then the other thing is just to remember that when you're looking at empirical formula, just remember that definition. You do not know exactly how many elements you have in your molecule. You don't know exactly how many of each element you have. And because it's just a ratio, and because a lot of different molecules that are out there in the universe have certain numbers of electrons that make them stable, you'll notice that a ton of molecules will have the same empirical formula, even though they have different molecular formulas. So in this example, we can see that our first and third examples happen to have the exact same empirical formula. Don't read into it. It doesn't mean anything particularly fascinating about it. You're going to see tons of examples where empirical is the same and molecular is different. It's completely fine to have a bunch of different problems where your empirical is the same, even though the molecular formula is different. It's just something that happens. All right, that was a quick breakdown of empirical formula. Hope it was helpful and happy studying. Hey, I hope you liked that video. Please feel free to subscribe, click around, and watch my other tutorials. And as always, happy studying.